in sport.
Rangers' Yulgal Bear is apologising to Paul Lambert after the tackle which left the Celtic skipper concussed and out of Saturday's Scotland-England match. The German's told the Rangers news he feels guilty because he wanted Lambert to help beat England.
Where's your sport?
Murder. Meanwhile, Kevin Keegan's promising to name Michael Owen for England if he's fully recovered from his hamstring injury by the weekend. There's confusion at Wycombe Wanderers after their ground was evacuated just before the penalty shootout in their FA Cup first round replay. The fire alarm sounded and the FA must now decide what happens after 210 minutes of play. Fulham moved fourth in the first division after beating Portsmouth 1-0. And Spurs have lost their protest about Kaiserslautern changing their team sheet when they heard David Ginola was only a substitute for last week's UEFA Cup tie. The German side have been fined £400, but the result still stands. Virgin Sports, I'm Webbo.
The weather, thick fog in places at first, otherwise mostly dry with sunny spells, highs of 11. Virgin News, I'm Barry Ann Corrigan.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Barry Ann.
The Christopher Evans Breakfast Show on Virgin Radio.
Good morning. I'm in so much trouble. I'd just like to share that with you. I've never been in this much trouble ever, apart from maybe once.
Just once.
In my life before.
Yeah.
But I am in so much trouble this morning. And I'm so happy to be in the safety of a locked studio. I am beyond in trouble. Anyway, today's phone-in, listeners, is are you having therapy? And if so, why? 0500 30 12 15. Or are you a therapist? And if so, what are people having therapy for? Because I'm really considering it today.
Well, I don't, not so much therapy, I think, more of a bodyguard, I'd probably be more used to it. I'd have thought, a big blow.
Seriously, if you're having therapy now, I want to know why. 0500 30 12 15. Or if you're a therapist, why are people coming to you? You can email us, team@thebreakfastshow.com, or you can fax us 0645 30 1197. Dan?
Yeah?
You've known me for 6 years?
Yes, something like that, yeah.
How much trouble am I in today?
Loads.
Paul, you've known me for 10 years.
10 years,
How much trouble am I in today?
An awful lot, I must admit.
John!
You are.
Yo. More than you could ever imagine.
Good morning, our virgin. Good morning, virgin, 12:15 a.m.
It's 6:34. And it's Wednesday, November 10, 1999. This could be the last breakfast show we ever do. So let's make the most of it. Here come the Rolling Stones!
Men are gentle, borrow queen in
thank you.
Road Radio fans.
22 to 7.
Games stranger than fears. When will they go from here? When will they stop? I believe that fate has brought us here, and we should be together back.
I tried before that, the Rolling Stones. Man, Honky Tonk Woman, on the way. Wow! Wow! The next two records we're going to play are Black Grape and Bob Marley. Wow! That's fantastic. I'm so excited about that. Okay, today I'm officially in so much trouble, you have no idea how much trouble I'm in. The people in the studio have some idea, but really... no idea, to
be honest. No, not really. I mean, good bit of a clue.
You have no idea how I feel, though.
No, right.
You know when you're scared about something and you feel like you get that feeling in your belly?
Yes. Right.
Fear and loathing.
Yes.
Right, and it's so horrible.
Yeah.
I've got that in my arms.
Well, really?
My arms are scared.
It spreads.
Because you keep jumping about like this from left to right, I notice.
I am in so much trouble.
Left foot to right.
Have you got any idea what it's like to wake up in a hotel room this morning and think, oh my God, I'm in a hotel room. And then look round and there are other people there.
Oh.
In bed with you.
Oh, nice.
And one of them is Virgin Sport and Webber.
When you woke up and looked at him, did he go, I'm Webber?
Yeah, Virgin Sport, I'm Webber. I woke up in bed this morning with the sports reporter and some other people as well.
He's a very attractive man.
But then I looked round the room and there was devastation around the room.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm thinking, where the heck are what happened last night? I'm trying to piece it together. All I know is that I am in so much trouble. You have no idea how much trouble I'm in. You have
no idea.
I have never been in this much trouble.
Ever.
We need an excuse. You need an excuse.
What?
We need an excuse. We need our listeners to call in with an excuse.
No, there is no excuse. I'm beyond excuses. I'm just in trouble.
Well, somebody might have a cool group of an excuse
we've got
out
to
there.
Sort it out,
the only thing
somebody might have a cool group of an excuse.
Yeah. The only thing I can do is get my passport
right
sent here, because I can't go home, right? Get it sent here. I get a car from here today to the airport and just go away. And I'm going to do everyone a favour, and I'm just going to get out of everybody's life. Yours included. You'll be fine without me. You've all got good careers now. You don't need me anymore. For a few years, you needed me. You needed this. You needed the hub of the wheel. But now you don't. I'm going to go, right? I've got a few quid. I'm not got as much as I would have. If I leave today, I'm not got as much as I would have if I don't leave today.
Well, will that fear and loathing go away if you run away like that?
No, of course not. But well, it'll do you all a favour. No, but I might have a chance, a slight chance of going to heaven. A slight chance. Because now I am firmly booked into hell. Firmly booked. I have a block booking in hell.
If there are any vicars listening, could you phone in? Yeah. What are the chances? What are the odds on Chris going to heaven? If
We would need therapists to phone in, the people who are having therapy, religious leaders phoning phone in and
bookmakers just give us the odds please on that. William Hill,
just give us some help. 0500 30 12 15, please give me some help now. And advise me what to do with my life, which is in tatters at the moment. Oh god.
Oh my goodness.
After the amount of money you spent yesterday, are you sure you've got enough to fly away?
That sounds like I'm showing off, and I'm not showing off.
No, but we did go, I mean...
We went potty yesterday.
We did go mad.
We went everybody who works on the show went out for lunch, because we thought it'd be a real, you know, bonding session. I wish we'd never gone out for lunch. Yesterday was the worst day of my life, apart from today, which is definitely going to be worse. I'm in so much trouble.
Oh, dear.
Can anybody give us any help at all? This could really, I'm not joking, this could be the last radio show I personally am ever involved in. It's 16 minutes to 7.
Would you like another poppadum?
Thank you.
Up around the country, or if you're just finishing your night shift, or you're just restless and you can't sleep and you're worried about things, don't worry about a damn thing, because I'm in so much more trouble than anybody else in the country. I'm not joking. Varianne has some advice for me, don't you, Vazza? What is it?
Well, it's so bad you have to just stand back and go ha 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 and laugh.
Nice one.
Varianne just said, as I was walking down the corridor, Chris, it's so bad it couldn't be any worse. Apart from, in fact, if I was ill, if I had an illness.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that can be worse, isn't it?
Yeah.
If one of my friends, one of my friends has got an illness, so and he's in much worse off state than I am. Yeah. My thoughts are with him and his family. But apart, you know, notwithstanding illness, could I be in any more trouble?
No. not possibly at all, no.
And Varianne is the voice of reason.
Good advice to stand back.
The French say they're ready to go to court over the beef ban. The country's consumer affairs minister is quoted as saying France does not want to face legal action, but is ready to defend the charges if consumers don't get adequate guarantees. Intelligence documents published today show the microwaves from mobile phones caused brain damage as long ago as the 1970s. And there's a separate warning that cradling any kind of phone on your shoulder can be fatal. Paul Hutton reports. Sorry, I'm just going through...
Not bad, but you need a Scottish accent.
Yeah, but I'm just going to... I'm seeing if I can do that as a future career.
It's your next gig, isn't it?
What?
It's going to be your next gig somewhere else here.
Yeah, do you know where?
In America.
In the Galapagos Islands.
Oh, yeah, big on news here.
If you've got any advice for me at all, 0500 30 12 15, just any advice about how to gain some kind of responsibility
in my life. If you want to leg it, there's a great a potential new airline that would be perfect for you to escape on.
What's it called?
Well, Peter Stringfellow is going to start his own airline.
Yes.
Right, so it's going to be the complete opposite from EasyJet. So where EasyJet is no frills or anything, Stringfellow is going to have the whole lot, every possible thrill, including performances by the gorgeous Stringfellow's angels.
Oh, not that's what I'm saying.
Is it lap dancing aeroplane? Lap dancing aeroplane. You get around over London.
I've never had a lap dance.
Flaps you know, down, love.
I've never had a lap dance in my life. Had a lap dance ever.
No,
you have.
I know, yeah. Only so that you can stand on the side and watch. You're like the coach in the dugout.
That's what friends are for. It's 6:56. Here we go.
In London, oil giant BP Amoco helps boost markets. In the city, the FTSE jumped 61 points to close at 6,435, reassured by Gordon Brown's pre-budget statement. In the States, Wall Street had a wobbly day's trading over interest rate worries, and the Dow Jones closed down 101 points at 10,617. And in the East, the Nikkei closed up 275 points and is currently standing at 18,568. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. We have a vicar on the telephone from Southend. Hello.
Hi.
Who's
Hi,
this?
Chris.
Hello, who's this?
This is Steve from Southend.
Hello, how are you?
Yes, all right, thanks.
Do you have any advice for me at all in life, generally? Shall I turn to the Lord?
That's good advice. All I was going to say is there's nothing that you could have done, and I don't know exactly what it is, that is too bad that God couldn't forgive you and redeem your situation and give you credibility again.
But how do you get to that point, though?
Well, you just have to put your hands up and confess that all of us in the same boat, we've all done things wrong. Well, if you've got a pass mark in life and the pass mark's 50, okay, if I was to get 49 and you were only to get 5,
yeah.
You know, we both failed the test. So it's not about how good you are, but it's about admitting that you have failed, that you are a sinner, but by asking the Lord in, he can forgive your sins.
Why does one continue to sin then?
Why does one?
Yeah.
It's because we're born into a world where we're all in a fallen state. You know, generations before us have sinned, and it's almost come down the bloodline. And the way of dealing with that is accepting the one that came into the world that never sinned. And that's why he was born of virgin birth, that's Jesus. And he can change your life.
But I've read lots of books about religion, and also about Hinduism, and about Buddhism, and about the fact that desire is the root of all evil. Would you agree with that?
I wouldn't say desire itself. Desire can be one of the sins if it's the wrong kind of desire. But you can have a desire to do good things. You can have a desire to want to go the right way in life.
But it's so easy to go the right way in life, isn't it? But I always think it's going to be boring.
Right. Yeah, not necessarily, because that can bring a joy in your life and a peace in your life that's indescribable.
But if we get...
I can understand why some of the other stuff might look tempting. You might want to go a certain way, but...
But if we get peace and joy and contentment, right?
Yeah.
Which is, I suppose, what everybody strives for.
Yeah.
Sure.
If we get that, aren't we then just treading water till we die?
Not necessarily. What you're doing is you're enjoying the future life in the now life.
Yeah.
So everything that's going to be wonderful and beautiful, everything's put right again, you can taste some of that now. You know, you don't have to... There's a saying that goes, it's not pie in the sky when you die, but it's steak on the plate while you wait.
Oh, nice sounds. Well, listen, thanks for talking to me.
No problem.
I need this kind of help this morning.
Yeah.
I'm not joking.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Well, I hope it all works out.
Cheers, Steve.
Okay,
Steve from Southend, that was a lovely phone call. Thank you, Steve.
Nice, nice chat.
I need this kind of help now. 0500 30 12 15. Please. Are you seeing a therapist? If so, why? If you are a therapist, who's seeing you and why? And by the way, the bloke in steps is paid more than the women. And we'll talk about that today.
Oh, yeah.
On the way, Bob Marley, don't go away. This is Virgin Radio. It could be the last breakfast show we ever do, and I'm not joking.
Weather, thick fog in places at first, otherwise mostly dry with sunny spells. Highs of 11, Virgin News, I'm Barry Ann Corrigan.
Right, fans, here we go. The Christopher Evans Breakfast Show on Virgin Radio.
With Sky Digital.
Presenting Holyfield versus Lewis, the rematch. Who will be the undisputed heavyweight champion of the world? Find out live only on Sky Box Office this Saturday from 10 p.m.
Virgin. It's Wednesday, November 10, 1999. It's 7:04. 52 days to go until the year 2000. 3 days to go until Scotland play England.
don't worry about a thing. Virgin Radio, 12:15 a.m. across the country, FM 105.8 in London and the southeast around the world on the internet. Good morning, the world. How are you today? Give us a call if you like from anywhere on planet Earth on 0044 171 434 3232. So radio is a brilliant invention, and from now on, we're never going to waste it, we're never going to take it for granted, and we're going to do something brilliant every day. This could be the last breakfast show we're ever involved in, me anyway, because I could well be getting on a plane today and just going away and doing you all a favour. Holly said you can't run away from things today, but I'm not running away from it for my sake. I'm getting out of everybody else's hair. I'm going to stop being their nightmare. Because I am a nightmare. And I will get round to you eventually. If you're listening to this show, I will get round to you eventually, and I will ruin your life too.
There's only 60 million people in this country.
It's 8 minutes past seven. So what we're going to do today, please, if you're seeing a therapist, I want to know why. If you are a therapist and you're treating people, what kind of things are they seeing you for? Or generally, can you help me? 0530 1215, because this is the best therapy of all on the radio. We'll talk about the papers, we'll give you the sport, we'll give you the news and the travel and the weather. So it's going to give you a sense of Wednesday the 10th of November as well. But between now and 9:30, we're going to find so many things out, I promise you. I'm in so much trouble. If you've just woken up, I'm beyond trouble. I woke up this morning in a hotel room with other people in the bed.
I'm Webbo.
One of them was Webbo, our sports reporter. There were other people in the bed too. I have no idea what happened at all. Well, I have some idea. Before Dan left anyway, I remember that bit.
Were you fully clothed?
What? Of course not. Totally naked. Not a stitch on, sir. Not a stitch on.
What, and Webbo?
What?
And Webbo?
No, Webbo had his...
tattoos on.
No, Webbo had his Grundy's on. His Alan Wickers. But give us a call now. We got a call on line five here now. This is from Chloe Freeman. Hello, Chloe.
Oh, hello, Chris.
Hello, darling.
I really just wanted to say this to you, Chris, because I can see, you know, it's obvious you're in a lot of muck now.
Yeah.
You know what that guy was saying about you shouldn't have desires? That isn't the answer, Chris. What is the point of being alive if you can't have what you want? But what goes wrong for people is they don't know the difference between what's good for you and what's bad for you.
Can you educate us, then? Can you tell us?
Yes, definitely. In a word, Chris, you'll think I'm balmy, but I'm not the type. I chant Namu Rengeko, and I've been doing it for 12 years. Before this, I used to keep going round in circles. I'd come back to the same old spot. Whatever I tried, I'd still be in muck. But this puts you in tune with the law of cause and effect in the universe. Just by chanting, it sounds balmy, I know. It's like unlocking a quality that you have inside yourself that enables you to see the truth and the way for you. We're all here to be happy, and your desires are the path to enlightenment, because you chant to fulfill them and you get the wisdom to see how to do it. So maybe what's caused your problem is, you know, go for what you want, but you're not using your Buddha wisdom, you're using your head, which is made up of your past experiences and your karma. And that's why you keep screwing up. Sorry, I don't mean to be rude, perhaps you don't keep screwing up. But that's why you're in a bit of a hole now. Does that make sense?
Total sense, and I thank you very much for your phone call. I love this. More calls, please. Harry the Doc. Excuse me, Harry the dog is on line six. Hello, Harry.
Chrissy, baby.
Hello, Harry.
Hi, mate.
What's going on?
Listen, don't listen to what that woman says. You get in the back of Mark's head, we'll have a chat, Arthur, and I'll sort all your problems out.
Harry, how will you sort my problems out?
Cab drivers can sort everyone's problems out, Chris. You should know that. We're all philosophers.
Yeah?
Yeah, honest, mate.
But if I got in the back of your cab, I wouldn't get a word in edgeways, would I?
No, I'm the strong silent type, you can tell, can't you?
The strong silent type.
Oh, we like you.
It's 11 minutes past seven. On today's show, we're going to sort out Jamie's problems. We're going to sort out Dan's problems. We're going to sort out Holly's problems. Because it's not only me that's got problems.
Don't bring us all into it.
Holly, you've got problems.
Don't you even think about bringing me into it.
Why can't I sort your problems out as well?
I haven't got any problems.
You haven't. I'll be telling the world what they are.
But will
between
you?
Now and 9:30. We're going to sort out Dan's problems.
Oh, we look forward to ours.
And we're going to sort out Jamie's problems as well.
Has John got any problems?
Yes.
Monday finds you like a bomb. It's been left ticking there too long.
Thanks, and I saved the world today. This is Virgin Radio, 12:15 a.m. across the country, FM 105.8 in London and the South East. Virgin Sport on Wubbo. Morrissey plays the Leeds Town and Country Club this evening. Nobody will turn up for that.
All the students in Leeds, though.
No, he's past it.
Is he?
Yeah. He opens with a game of bingo. Van Morrison plays the last date of his tour at the Brighton Centre. And most importantly of all, Posh Spice turns on London's Bond Street lights at 6 o'clock.
Yes, Christmas lights.
It's 7:15. I hope you're all right today. Give us a call. We're going to sort out everybody's problems that work on the show. Holly's got a problem. She's got a big problem. So you have.
What is it?
I'll tell you in a moment. You know what it is anyway.
I don't know what it is. Should we have a discussion before we do it
on air? Let's do it on the air.
Okay.
Dan's got a problem.
What's that then?
I'll tell you on the air.
We all have problems.
Because the whole point is, I am a focal void for problems. You know, John has said it before, he knows I am a nutcase. Yes?
Oh, yes.
Totally.
Yeah,
properly.
Oh, yeah.
Before, you said before, I wasn't clinically insane.
You're not clinically.
But you think I'm maybe going that way now.
Slightly bonkers, there's no question about that.
Okay. Yeah. But even though I'm insane, in a strange kind of way, I still can look at you lot and I know what your problems are. And I think we should discuss them. It's time to get them out and let's sort them out. Yeah? Jamie has a major problem in his life. We all know what it is.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that today. You have a problem in your life, I know what that is. We're going to talk about that today. Dan has a problem. John, not so much, but John can just be there for the rest of us. We're going to sort it out today with your help. 0500 30 12 15. Especially if you're religious. Let's go religion nuts. Come on. The blokes from Steps are paid double the girls' wages.
Amen.
Do you know that?
That's all you need to know.
That's all you need to know.
It's a big show.
You think you've got big problems.
Page 7 of The Sun. Steps fellas are paid double the girls' wages. The band is in crisis.
Quite rightly, sir.
They've got problems.
It's 7:21. Got a fax here from Val. Christoph, I'm a therapist. Well, the last bit anyway. Me too, Val. Me too. This is the record of the week. Did I say that? Well, it is. 7:22.
He's walking along that lonely mile. And every time I do, I keep seeing this picture of you. Here comes my baby.
song, our record of the week, The Mavericks. And Here Comes My Baby at 7:24. So Nick Fallow's going to get married again. That's the big news.
We know what he's done.
What?
He's issued that photograph. They've had an official portrait photograph taken.
Why?
Issued it to the press so the press don't have to bother them. So they say, there you go, that's the photo. That's what we look like. Leave us alone.
What are you saying?
I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying what I'm saying.
It sounds like you're saying something to me. Gordon Brown had a budget on his hands yesterday, apparently, and he's going to give old age pensioners, 4 million of them, free TV licenses, which I think is a very good idea.
Absolutely.
Be a good idea if you gave them TVs as well, though.
Mm.
And that's also important. Listen, we've got to sort things out generally. Holly's got a major problem, Dan's got a problem, Jamie's got a problem, I've got a million problems. See, my problem started in earnest probably 10 years ago. My mum said, I got on the train to go to London.
Yeah.
And she said, it'll be the undoing of you, that London. And for 10 years, she's phoned me up every week and said, are you all right? I said, yeah, Mum, it's not going to happen. The undoing isn't going to happen. But now, after 10 years, it's happened. And she was right.
Do you know what? Also, I feel that I failed you, Mum, as well, because I remember when I first met Minnie, which was a long time ago, she said to me, oh, hey, love, you will look after him, won't you? And I said, don't you worry, Minnie, he's fine with me, I'll take good care of him. And in fact, last time I saw her, she was down, about a month ago, so she said, oh, remember what I said now, you will look after him, won't you? I said, Minnie, he's fine. And that's when I fell asleep on the sofa. I do feel that I failed your mum as
but
well.
But 2 months ago, it went wrong in earnest because I changed my diet. And it's had a massive imbalance effect on my life.
It
has.
It's getting lost.
I am supposed to be fat, right?
Yeah.
You're not.
No, but I'm supposed to be fat.
But I've known you for 10 years and you've never been fat. If you're supposed to be fat, you'd be up and down like a yo-yo.
I'm supposed to be fat.
He is.
And working class.
In fact,
I'm not. I'm thin, and I've got a few quid.
Right.
And it's not what I'm supposed to be, because you're supposed to be what you're supposed to be, and eventually you'll have to go back to that.
Daft.
Absolutely.
Daft.
See, it's all right, because you're quite middle class, Hol.
Yeah.
Right? Dan's middle class and Jamie's middle class, but that brings its own problems, as we've discussed before.
But where you're born and who you're born to and what state you're born in there is no destiny of where you're going to be.
Well, I'll tell you what, we'll get...
That doesn't mean you should stay there for the rest of your life.
Okay, I want to talk to some listeners now, because they're phoning in their droves. 0500 30 12 15, if you're religious or you're a vicar, we just give us some wisdom. If you're a therapist, we want your wisdom. If you're having therapy, we want to know why and has it helped. Please give us a call right now. We're going to find a few things out. In a moment or two, we're going to get on to Jamie's problem. Jamie's got a massive problem in his life, and we're going to discuss that this morning. If that's okay with you, Jim.
Yeah, come on.
Well, I think we have done for the last hour, Jamie.
Okay,
yeah?
All right.
And then we'll talk about Holly's got a problem, and Dan's got a little problem. Dan's problem is not as big as Holly's. Holly's isn't as big as Jamie's. Jamie's isn't as big as mine. And John's doing fine the way he is. Butch Gibbons is on the phone. Hello, Butch.
Hello, Chris. How's it going, mate?
Okay.
Right, now, what you need to do, Chris, tonight get out, and whatever you done last night, knock 10 times on top of it, right?
Yes.
Single man. And then that way, today's problems will be minuscule.
Now that is actually a very good theory. It's a good theory.
So I got to go out and get in more trouble tonight. So today seems like I'm not in that much trouble.
That's right, yeah.
Well, what about tomorrow morning,
though?
Yeah, but then the next day go to it again and...
I think the law of diminishing returns will come into effect here somehow. It's 7:27 on Virgin Radio, your £1 million station. Shop and brimful of Asher on Virgin Radio. Coming up again at 8:10 this morning, somebody's chance to get a ticket to win £1 million. A And this morning we're playing for £1,000. Between 9 and 9.30 we go to Sri Lanka with McDonald's. That's McDonald's in our McBacon Roll competition. If you want to go to Sri Lanka and you've got a Virgin Radio car sticker and you've filled in the back and you've sent it off to us, we could be calling you between 9 and 9.30 this morning. If you haven't got a Virgin Radio car sticker, you've still got a couple of days to get one and send it off to us before Friday. We're giving holidays away all week between 9 and half past 9 with McDonald's. Go to any outlet in Great Britain and get a Virgin Radio car sticker. Also, why not pick up a McBacon roll for 99p at participating outlets?
So you don't have to say that bit.
What?
That little bit, participating.
No, I know, but I like to say...
You throw that in.
I like to say participating outlets.
Don't be a Sri Lanka. Get to McDonald's.
Can I just say this, though? Can I just say this, please, if you don't mind? Can I say hello, line three?
Yeah, good morning.
Hello, Darley Michael.
Good morning. Could I first thank you by playing one of my favourite records that brings back very fond memories?
Which one?
The one you've just played.
The Brimful of Asher?
That's the one.
Okay, what have you got to tell me?
Solace in the fact that life is similar to a journey through a busy town where the road planning continues to change and yet there's no one to guide you. So along the journey, we do make the occasional wrong turn and sometimes end up in completely the wrong end of town.
Yeah.
But without the journey, we will never reach our destination, which is Earth of Brahma.
Okay.
So one should take solace in the possessions and the friends that one has. If there is something special or someone special in one's life, then one should take solace in that and not worry too much about making mistakes. After all, we are only human.
Okay, Dali, how old are you?
30.
30 years old?
Yes.
When you were 7, did you think like this?
Not to the extent of this, but in an embryonic form, yes.
So when did you start to think to this extent, the things you do?
I woke up one morning about 10 years ago and realized that this is the way that I would feel for the rest of my life.
Why did you think that particular day?
I'm not entirely sure. I think I was going through a particularly low time myself.
Yeah? Why?
Similar to yourself, I had moved down to London 10 years ago and...
London is mad, isn't it?
It is very mad. I come from a very small town in Wales and knew no one, knew nothing, and was very naive. I was very hurt.
And to exist here, you have to be a bit mad.
You have to be very hard. You have to close your heart to a lot of things and a lot of people.
You do. That's a very good point. You have to close your heart to a lot of things and a lot of people to get on with it here. I mean, I'm not, you know, I'm not pleading sympathy, but I'm just saying, people around London are a bit mad. From the people who sweep the streets to the people who sit in the plushest office in the most expensive and successful and renowned merchant bank in the world, you know.
I think any big cities like that, if you go to New York, if you go to Manchester, big city life is tough.
Yeah.
And you can't. You have to be on your guard all the time. You can't be open. You can only be open with your friends.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, more of this, please. Are you seeing a therapist at the moment? If so, why? Is it helping? How much do they charge? And do they make you take your shoes off? 0530-1215, because they do make you take your shoes off.
Take your shoes off now.
Well, let's take them off now.
Shoes off, everybody.
Take our shoes off. Let's get grounded. Come on. We're going to sort everything out today, or at least we're going to start. Email us, team@thebreakfastshow.com. Let's take them off now.
Shoes off, everybody.
Take our shoes off. Let's get grounded. Come on. We're going to sort everything out today, or at least we're going to start. Email us, team@thebreakfastshow.com. Tell us anything you like. If you're a vicar, we want to hear from you. 0645 30 1197. If you've been near the brink of anything and managed to come back before falling over the edge, tell us about it today on the radio. From Crawford Drive in Westfield, Staffordshire, it's a letter from Sally Wallace.
Oh, Sal.
Yeah. Dear Chris, firstly, can I thank you for the idea of the golden moments, and secondly, ask you to play my choice. This song takes me back to when I was dating my first real boyfriend, Steve Anderson. Stevie! I was totally in love in that naive and innocent way. I could never hope to catch her again. Oh, oh, sad, but true. It was very special, and a year I'll always treasure, and this song was playing when we first kissed and remained our song. With greatest respect to my husband, whom I adore, I still wonder what Steve is up to whenever I hear this song, which is Marvin Gaye's How Sweet It Is. Greatest respect to her husband, who at the moment is livid. It's 20 minutes to 8, the golden moment, Marvin Gaye. Here we go.
I needed the shelter of someone's arms, and there you were. I needed someone to understand my ups and downs. Stop and thank you, baby. I wanna stop and thank you, baby. Hey now, how sweet it is to be loved by you. Oh baby, how sweet it is to be loved by you. Yes, it is. And I've been to myself. For me, there's you and nobody else. Stop and thank you, baby. I wanna stop and thank you, baby.
To go for moments, especially for you, send a good old-fashioned letter to a good old-fashioned request spot on the radio, and the address is the Golden Moments, number 1 Golden Square, Virgin Radio, London W1R4DJ.
Well, it's like sugar.
A nice letter with a little bit of prose or a simple sincere sentiment written in a lovely ink pen will do the job just fine. Melinda Messenger is pregnant. Congratulations, Melinda. She has a very successful marriage to Wayne, her childhood sweetheart.
He's a good lad, Wayne. Yeah.
They get on very well indeed. People think he's a little bit simple.
Not at all.
But he's not
really
simple.
Nice,
he's just a very mild-mannered, down-to-earth kind of guy. Yeah. And they're expecting a baby due in the late spring.
Yeah. Brilliant.
So well done. Congratulations. Yeah, maybe that's what life's all about. John, is that what you think life's all about?
Well, for me it is.
Yep.
Very important to me.
What, Melinda having a baby?
Yes, indeed.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, Holly, you think you've got something such, because if you've just tuned in, I'm in deep
doo-doo.
Deep doo-doo this morning, yeah, absolutely. Woke up today in a hotel room and went, oh my God.
I'm Webbo.
I'm in a hotel room. Next to me in bed, naked, was our sports reporter, John Webster.
I'm naked.
It is not funny, and I'm beyond trouble. But Holly says that I'm not in that much trouble because you've got a story about Seinfeld.
Oh, yeah, Jerry Seinfeld is getting married to a woman that he met the day after she came back off honeymoon to another man.
Now, is this in the programme or in real life?
No, this is real life.
This is real life. So she got married to the love of her life.
She's in a lot of trouble.
Exactly. She got married to the man of her dreams, came back from honeymoon, met Jerry Seinfeld in a gym, of all places, and 2 months later, her husband divorced him, and now they're getting married. So everything turned out, you know, in the end, it all worked itself out. But she was in a lot of trouble, and she dealt with it, and she thought, oh, well, hold on a minute. The man I've just married that I thought was the right person is, oh, my God, why have I done that? And then she's gone on, and she met Jerry, and obviously thought, Seinfeld's the man for me.
Okay, 0500 30 12 15. Give us a call right now if you're religious or if you're seeing a therapist. We want to know why, and is it helping? If you're a therapist, why are people seeing you, and do you help them, and do you make them take the shoes off? You can fax us 0645 30 11.
It's good. I like the shoes off.
Or you can email us team@thebreakfastshow.com. Holly's got a problem. John's not got a problem. Dan has got a problem. Jamie's got a problem, and we're going to discuss those in a moment or two, if you don't mind, on this day. On this 10th of November day, 1999, coming up, a word about the weather and the big news, plus John somehow wants me to play 10cc and Rubber Bullet. But I don't know if I can. I've got it on and you can hear it now.
But I don't know whether we can stick it in or not. Do you think we can stick it in, John?
Well, I think there's probably room somewhere within the next hour and a half.
Okay, coming up next on the show, definitely, this from Simply Red. When we come back in 3 minutes from now, this is Virgin. It's Wednesday, November 10th, 1999. Good morning, welcome to the show. Welcome to a Wednesday in your life and ours. How are you today? Hope everything's fine in your life. Steps are in trouble. Chart topper Steps were in crisis last night after the band's three girls discovered the lads have paid thousands of pounds more. Lee Latchford-Evans has pocketed over 100 grand in the past 6 months, and Ian Watkins, known as H, around 80 grand. But Lisa, Faye and Claire get about half the boys' salary. Why? Why do they do that? I don't know. The boys are more in demand. I've got no idea why. John thinks that that's quite right, and women should be kept in their place.
I do indeed.
It's a mad no-brainer. I've got the most blocked-up nose in the
Suddenly,
world.
Suddenly, yeah. Where's that come from?
Oh, I've had it all week.
Oh, have you?
Yeah, yeah.
Coming out now.
That's a weird thing. Yeah. I've changed my diet. It's weird. I'm getting healthy. But apparently to get healthy, you've got to get ill first. Sick in the head, in the body. Big news today, mobile phones can scramble your brain, apparently. And this has been happening since 1970.
Yeah.
That's the new news today. Do phones affect us? Are they sending us all mad? Is it something that's been sent to see how insane we really are? We fill ourselves with smoke, don't we?
Yeah.
You have a cigarette. That's a mad thing to do. Acts as a chimney for no apparent reason. And now we are knowingly frazzling our brains. Knowingly. Knowingly doing it.
Yeah.
Mad. That is insane behaviour. But are we doing that at all? Because there is a school of thought that says our brain is in the base of our spine. That's really where our brain is. And the thing in our head is the thing that converts the thoughts from our brain, which is in our back, into thoughts.
Really? I've never heard of that.
Well, neurologists are scared to admit it because they've done so much work on the thing in our head, the muscle in our head known as our brain, that they would not admit that in fact our real brain is right in the center of our back. And it's got a special name, I can't remember what it's called, but it's all to do with our central nervous system. And if you think about your gut feeling, your gut feeling is right at the pit of your stomach.
Sure.
And your central nervous system is at the bottom of your spinal cord. So it makes sense that actually that is where the brain is. It's not in your head at all. What about that then?
Yeah, I don't go for that.
No, I know. Well, you wouldn't, because you're not opening your brain, because you don't even know where it is. Now, listen, as far as fitness is concerned, if you're ill, I've often thought if I've got a bit of flu coming on or a cold like I have at the moment, if I go to the gym and have a good run, it's good for me. But it's not, it's bad for you. Do you know why?
Why is that?
Because it pumps all the germs around your body at twice the speed, and they can infect you even more. So if you're ill, don't try and get fit.
Who told you that?
What's her name? What's the name of him?
Who? Fitness instructor.
Fitness guru.
Cleaner.
No, not the cleaner, no.
What? Masseuse.
Yeah, but she's a...
Oh, she's
a therapist.
No, she's a whore.
I'd finish that word if I were you.
Yes. Homeopathic.
All right.
She's homeopathic.
Right.
And she said that if you exercise, the germs go around your body at double the speed and you're in big trouble, pal. But she knows what she's talking about, John, because she knows where her brain is. The base of her spine.
She had a good look for yours as well. Well, I don't agree with that either.
Well, you're just being argumentative.
No, I'm not at all, because what it is...
Here's
the story
of
phonics.
Now, I know. Okay, all right. 4 to 8. Okay, Mike the Vicar is on the phone. Let's talk to Mike the Vicar today. Hello, Mike.
Good morning, Chris.
How are you, pal?
I'm very well, and you?
Well, you know.
So.
No, clearly not. That's why you're phoning.
So, can you help me, Father?
Yeah, I certainly can.
Come on, tell us.
Talk to the one who made you, Chris.
Okay, my mum.
Yeah, well, beyond that.
What, God?
God, yeah.
What do you say to him, though?
You just say, Lord, if you're there, show me. I want to know.
And how would he show us, then?
Pardon?
How will he show us that he's there?
Well,
he'd probably show you in
a number of ways.
Okay.
He knows exactly what you need.
Yeah.
And he made you, and he made you for a relationship with himself.
Now, I'm not disputing the fact that God exists, right?
Yeah.
But what I'd really like to know, honestly, because nobody's ever been able to explain this to me.
Okay.
How do you know God exists?
How do I know?
Yeah, and I'm not saying he doesn't, by the way. I just want to know personally how you, Mike, know.
Well, I know.
Do you know for a fact?
Yeah, I do.
So, like, we know that Scotland play England on Saturday.
Yeah.
Do you know that much that God exists?
I know more than that, Chris.
Well, tell us how, because I'd like to share this.
Okay. Well, I know God exists because he changed my life.
But
it was like the difference between watching a black and white TV and then getting a colour TV.
So how do you know that it wasn't you that changed your life?
Because I'm not able to do that.
So how did he change your life?
Well, he changed my outlook on life. He helped me with a lot of insecurities.
How? Tell us how. Which address do we write to? Which phone number do we call?
Yeah.
Well, you just talk to him. Once people discover that they can have a relationship with the God who made them,
yep.
The purpose of their life becomes clear. I'm not perfect, but we try and fill it with so many other things and discover why we're here.
Yep.
And then at the end, it's too late, and all the things that we spent money on or we looked to and the relationships that we had that didn't work out and all the rest of it, we find out that they don't really fulfill the gap that we all have in our lives.
Are you a proper vicar?
Yeah.
Do you listen to the show regularly?
I do, Chris, yeah, every morning.
What do you think of it?
I think it's great. I enjoy it. I don't know. Sometimes with sort of the relationship thing and all the rest of it, maybe veers a bit too far, but, you know, I enjoy the music and I pray for you, actually, Chris. I've prayed for you.
Go on.
What now?
No, would
you have done in the past?
I have done in the past, yeah.
What particular aspect have you prayed for?
I've just prayed for you and that God would bless your life and that you would discover him.
Thank you.
And the reason God put you here.
What do you think of the new Cliff Richard single?
I've no idea. I've never heard it.
Well, I'm going to play it for you in a minute.
Okay.
It's dreadful.
It's terrible.
Well, thanks for calling.
All right, thank you.
No problem at all.
Okay.
More calls from vicars. I like this. Do you?
This
is good, isn't it?
Interesting.
0530 1215. Give us a call if you're a vicar, if you're religious, maybe you're part of another religion. Don't mind, really. As long as it made you happy, give us a call. Email us. Or if you're a therapist, call up. John needs a bit of help. It's time to go to the ads, and then we'll be late for the news, which means we'll be chasing our tail for the next half an hour, but that's all right. We can do that. We've done it before.
The result stands. Virgin Sports, I'm Webbo.
The weather, showery in the southeast, dry and bright, everywhere else feeling cold with highs of 11. Virgin News, I'm Barry Ann Corrigal.
Thanks, guys. It's 7 minutes past eight. Here's Robbie.
the one. Dear Chris, do you want some facts about counselling? If the answer is no, please say no thanks. I'll live my life free of guilt, freeloaders and quackery. After all, no one gets a blueprint. If the answer is yes, please say cuckoo cuckoo. From Mick. Mick, I think you know the answer.
Calling me
up. Cuckoo. She's cuckoo. She's the one. This is the Breakfast Show on Virgin Radio. On Wednesday morning. I hope you're having a nice day so far. What's the big news, John?
The big news today is that you are in more trouble than you've ever been in your life. And that is it. That seriously is the big news.
Okay, let's
there
leave it there.
There is no other news.
Let's leave it there.
Apart from a man in Bristol who's had the name of the heart surgeon who saved his life tattooed on his arm. And when I read that, I thought, thank God he didn't circumcise him.
Circumcise him? You nearly got that out, John.
I was so excited.
Right, that out. Yeah. Van Morrison plays Brighton tonight. It's his last date of the UK tour. If you're anywhere in Britain, get on a train now and go to Brighton, because you should see Van Morrison while he's still part of the human race, because he's a genius.
Brilliant.
It's time for the competition.
Hello. This is Paul.
Hello, Paul. Paul Middleton, yeah?
From Stoke-on-Trent, yeah.
How are you, Paul?
I'm fine, thanks.
Why didn't you answer with the phrase that pays?
Because I'm too excited. I want to go to the toilet.
Too late, mate. Oh, sorry.
Paulie boy, you've blown it.
I have blown it.
You've got to answer with that phrase before you say anything else.
Oh, sorry.
It doesn't matter. There goes Paul, I'm afraid.
Oh, yes.
Paul has to answer, like everybody else
Absolutely.
Does, with this phrase.
You have to answer in five rings, and you have to say, morning, Christoph, I'm so excited I have to go to the toilet.
And then you get a chance to get a ticket to win a million. But Paul doesn't, which means somebody else will today. And today, the call will be carried over to Harriet's show again. Between 5 and 6, if you've called our number, Harriet could be calling your number. Our number is 09065-55-0022. You're playing for £1,000 if Harriet calls you this evening, but you must answer with, evening, Harriet. I'm so excited I've got to go to the toilet. Disco 2000 from Pulp. As we head towards the millennium. And how many days to go to the millennium, Paul? How many?
To the millennium, 52.
52 days to go.
Yep.
And how many days to go until we give away £1 million?
Until we give away £1 million, 31.
31 days to go until Christmas Eve. 31 days or 31 shows? 31 shows
yeah.
to go until we give away £1 million
That's
on
right.
the show. Somebody will be a millionaire. So we're having vicars on all morning, religious types from all different cultures and religions. And so for you, here is Cliff Richard's Lord's Prayer to the tune of O Lang Syne. From Huey Lewis and the News, but what was the year? It's 16 minutes past 8. 0530 1215. If you found happiness, you know joy, you've experienced contentment, tell us how. So today I woke up in a hotel room next to the sports reporter John.
I'm Webbo.
Yeah. I really did at 5 o'clock this morning, and I thought, that's it, enough is enough. Today's the day of revelation. It's gone too far. I've gone too nuts. Not anymore. It's going to stop. How do we stop it? Dear Chris, forget all the other stuff.
and the idea of leaving the country and follow these simple instructions, you sound as if you feel out of control. From what you've told us, your actions, they seem to be avoidance, like any addictive behaviour. I think your actions are your way of running from what's going on inside yourself. Here's what I think you should do. Go home, or anywhere quiet on your own, take an A4 pad and pen, start writing, start with your feelings, particularly the negative ones, because that's what causes the excesses, the drink, etc., staying out late at night, just trying to have a laugh all the time. Start with your fears, spend a few moments writing what comes to mind. I'm afraid of dot dot dot, I'm afraid that dot dot dot. Then start on your sorrow, I'm sad that dot dot dot, and carry on finding out what your negative feelings are. Go to anger, then regrets, then what you're ashamed or embarrassed of, then seeing this on the page, and write down out what you want to feel instead, what you want to happen, how you want to live your life. I got this from various sources, but mainly from a book by John Gray called How to Get What You Want and Want What You Have from Zoe Hazel. Zoe, thank you very much indeed. Zoe's 28 years old at home with a four-month-old baby, Dawn.
Oh, nice. Right.
That's one way of dealing with this problem. Here is a completely different way. Dear Chris, forget all the other stuff and the idea of leaving the country and follow these simple instructions. After the show, jump in the car and drive to either Moreton in Marsh or Stow-on-the-Wold. Book into a hotel in Stow the Royalist or the Grapevine, in Moreton, the Reddersdale. Throw your bags in the room and retire immediately to the nearest pub. I recommend that in Stow, the Queen's Head, or in Moreton, the Black Bear. Right. Order a pint of local ale, most important that it is brewed locally for this formula to work. Find a quiet corner in the pub, watch the world go by and chill out. A few pints later, all will become apparent. Best of luck, Mike in Hollywood. Now that's my favourite, that out of the two, that's the one.
That works for you. Yeah.
Is that and a Hamlet cigar maybe?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yep. Yeah. And that is most of the cause of the problem.
What? What is?
You go to the pub.
You are right. I mean, you are right. The base of the whole problem is me going to the pub. But I have to say, for the last 9 or 10 years, since I was on the Big Breakfast or working at GLR, the local radio station, I've done that. And that's where I've got all my stories from. And that's what I talk about every day.
Yeah, I was actually being flippant. I didn't mean to be, because it's not the cause of it.
No.
You know, that's what you enjoy. And that's what you derive a lot of pleasure from and a lot of fun from. Just being in that environment where you're with lots of different people, talking to lots of different people all the time. And that's actually what you like. That's the upshot.
We got a vicar on line six, a trainee vicar. Ordnance, hello.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm very well, thanks. Well, I've got a terrible cold, to be honest.
There's a lot of cold going around.
A lot of jam.
A lot of mucus. We've got the mucus in us.
I've got buckets of it.
So you're a trainee vicar?
Yeah.
So what's going on with you?
Well, I used to be a doctor. I'm still a doctor, but I'm learning to be a vicar because I've seen so many people in hospital really unwell get to the end of their lives and not have a clue, really. And you know, they've made a complete mess of them, and it's almost too late to do anything about it. So I'm trying to learn to become a vicar, so that while people are really well, I can help them to think about life while they're living it. And basically, life is about relationships, which is why, you know, your show's talked about relationships the whole time, why the soaps are full of it, why the papers are full of it. Relationships with other people, but also, perhaps more importantly, well, much more importantly, relationship with God. And we might like to, you know, try and run away from that, because obviously if there is a God, that's got implications for our life and the way we live it, but we can't actually get away from the fact that he made it. I mean, we all try and live our relationships, but we can't actually live them the way we want to. We keep messing up, we keep making mistakes, we keep hurting people in relationships, and, you know, all of the relationships that we live just prove to us eventually that we can't do life the way we want to, we can't do the relationships the way we want, and we need help, basically. We need help with our relationships with other people. We need help in our relationship with God as well. And one of the things I'm on a theological college trying to learn about is try to help people to see that there is a God who's there to help us and to sort it out. And the other guy was saying, the other vicar was on, Mike was saying earlier on, that he reckoned he could prove God as a fact. I'm not sure I could do that, because I'm not sure you can really prove very much about relationships as facts. I mean, I'm not sure I could prove as a fact that my wife loves me, but I know she does. And I'm not sure if I could prove in that sort of way anything about relationships, but I do know people, and you do know things, even if you can't prove it, and you can know God in that sort of way. And the best way to do that is to look at how God has spoken to us, about how God has made himself knowable as a person by coming into history as Jesus Christ, and you can find that out just by reading the pages of the New Testament. You can see what God is like as he came 2,000 years ago as a man and walked around, and that's the key to starting to put relationships right with God and with others.
I take on board everything you've said, but how do we know that the Bible is not a work of fiction?
Well, the best way is to start reading it, because when you start reading it, and it does unfortunately take a little bit of time, but it's worth it, when you start reading it, you start
finding out that it's got a power in it, to be honest. You find that it's introducing you not just to a dead person of history, but to a man who's alive, who starts asking you questions and giving you answers.
So that's the first step?
That's the first step.
Can I just say thank you very much for calling, because I think the first point you raised is the most important one, the fact that you were a doctor, and the fact that you've seen a lot of people dying.
Yeah.
And I think that that is a revelation within itself, and you've seen how unhappy they are, and you actually said they a lot of them have messed their lives up and made a failure of it, and that has made you do something about it.
Yeah.
And I think that that is the most credible thing that anybody said this morning, so thank you very much for calling.
You're welcome.
Cheers. Got a point, doesn't he?
He's very good,
He's seen people dying, and he's seen how unhappy they are. Because it is, I mean, that is the best example of this, the fact that this is not a rehearsal.
I thought one of the main points he made there was that, because we've been asking all morning, well, you know, how do you know? Describe this God. And he said, you can't, but you just know. And when you know things, you just know, which you do. Because you say that as one of your key phrases that you use a lot. Well, I just know. I just know these things. I know that's the right way of doing something. I know that's where we should be going.
You know when you're wrong and you know when you're right. Yeah. And you don't need anybody to tell you.
No. Yeah, exactly. That was a valid point.
You can feel it.
Yeah.
It's 8:31. Rocking and rolling. On the way. Jamie's big problem. Let's try and sort that out. Dan's got a little problem. And Holly's got a little problem as well. Try and sort those out. If you can help in any way.
Virgin Sports, I'm Webbo.
The weather showery in the southeast, dry and sunny across the rest of the country, but feeling chilly with highs of 11. Virgin News, I'm Barry Ancorrigan.
Well, thank you, Mrs. News Lady, and my sleeping partner, the sports broadcaster, Mr. John Webster, who I woke up to in bed next to this morning. 8:36. This is Virgin 12:15 AM across the country. FM 105.8 in London and the South East playing Oasis for you. Who they're treating and for what, anonymously of course, and if you're having therapy you can call in, why you're having it, and is it doing any good, 0500 30 12 15. And also strangely, if you're religious or you work in religion in any way, shape or form, give us a call. And we're getting lots of those calls, and I thought we'd get more calls off therapists, but no, hardly any off therapists. Millions and millions of people calling in, thank you very much, but a lot of ministers and vicars and priests and Buddhists. And hardly any therapist at all. Email us, team@thebreakfastshow.com. Dear Chris and the crew, thought I would share with you something that was sent to me by my sister, Jenny, who lives in Utah. I think it fits in with your theme for today. It's not changed my life, but it has a strong message for the reader. Attitude determines attitude is the document. I woke up early today excited all over. What I get to do before the clock strikes midnight. I have responsibilities to fulfill today. I am important. My job is to choose what kind of day I'm going to have. And you can choose. It's totally up to you.
Oh, yeah.
Completely up to you. Do you want to have a good day or a bad day? And if people tune into you later on and, you know, phone up and try and get on your vibes and say, you're right, so now I've had a terrible day. That was your choice.
Yeah,
you chose to make it terrible. Today, you can complain because the weather is rainy, or you can be thankful that the grass is getting watered.
Mm-hmm.
You can feel sad that you don't have more money, or you can be glad that finances encourage you to plan purchases wisely and guide you away from wasting it. Mm-hmm. You can grumble about your health, or you can rejoice that you're still alive. You can lament over all that your parents didn't give you when you were growing up, or you can feel grateful that they allowed you to be born in the first place. You can cry because roses have thorns, or you can celebrate the fact that thorns have got roses. That's my favourite. You can mourn a lack of friends, or you can excitedly go and try and find some new relationships. You can whine because you've got to go to work, or you can shout for joy because you've got a job.
Yeah.
You can complain because you've got to go to school, or eagerly open your mind and fill it with new, rich tidbits of knowledge from your classes today. It's up to you. Today you can murmur dejectedly because you have to do housework, or you can feel honoured because you've been provided with a shelter. And you can make it look nice for people when they come around. You today stretches ahead of you, waiting to be shaped. And here you are, the sculptor who gets to do the shaping. How lucky are you? With a little help from above, what will today be like? Well, that's entirely up to you. I love that.
That's very true.
Thank you very much. P.S. it says at the bottom, leave Holly alone. Okay, calm down. We've got a Baptist minister on the phone. We're going to talk to Graham the Baptist in a moment or two after Beck and Sex Lies. This is Virgin 12:15 a.m. heading towards a holiday giveaway today to Sri Lanka with McDonald's.
I'll let you be my chaperone at the halfway home.
Today we talked about the battle between the sexes, between the men and women, and how men try and get it right for women, and women want it right from men, but we seem to be very good at messing it up. Maybe that's our choice as well. But this is from Jez Clark now. I thought this might fit the bill on yesterday's topic. Here's the lost chapter in Genesis. There is a lost chapter, and here it is. Adam was walking around the Garden of Eden feeling very lonely, so God asked him, "What is wrong with you, Adam?" Adam said he didn't have anyone to talk to. God said that he was going to make Adam a companion, and that it would be a woman. He said, "This person will gather food for you, cook for you, and when you discover clothing, she'll wash it for you. She'll always agree with every decision you make. She'll bear your children and never ask you to get up in the middle of the night to take care of them. She'll not nag you, and will always be the first to admit she was wrong when you've had a disagreement. She will never have a headache, and will freely give you love and passion whenever you need it." So Adam asked God, "And what will a woman like this cost?" And God replied, "An arm and a leg." Then Adam asked, "What can I get for a rib?" The rest is history. It's 14 minutes to 9 o'clock. Graham the Baptist is on the phone. Hello, Graham.
Hi, Chris.
How are you?
Yeah, pretty well, thanks.
What can you tell us?
Well, Chris, and just following up what you read something out just a minute ago.
Yeah.
It's all about your choices you make in life.
Mm.
You said a bit earlier that life isn't a rehearsal, and you're absolutely right. You've only got one go at life. Now, if you're finding you're unhappy in your life, it's a sign that things aren't working. Perhaps what you've got to do is go back and look at choices you've made in the past and accept responsibility for them. Choices perhaps where you've upset people, choices where you've been upset through them. But when you make choices and when things go wrong, you've got to say, do I fix this now or do I just cover it over? Now, 10 years down the line, you're still having problems. Looks to me like you're just covering things over.
Mm.
You've got choices to make now. What are you going to do?
And what time do you think in our life do things begin to go wrong?
Well, Chris, it just depends, doesn't it? I mean, where I'm the minister in Dagenham, and I see kids of sort of 12 whose lives are falling apart due to families ending and things like that. I don't know if it's the time when things start to go wrong. It's when they do, what will you do about it?
Yeah, taking responsibility or turning a blind eye.
Yeah, absolutely right, Holly, taking responsibility.
But everybody has the ability, and everybody has the habit, don't they, of lying to themselves and everybody else every day.
Yeah.
So why do we do that? Why don't we just all be honest with each other all the time?
Perhaps because we're scared of being too open with people, we're scared of being too vulnerable with people. If you're open with people, you open yourself up to being hurt.
Yeah.
If you lie, you put up a front, and maybe you lie for so long, you've put up quite an armour around you.
But if you lie, I mean, you're just basically topping yourself up with sadness, aren't you?
You tell a lie, it just gets bigger and bigger if you try and cover it over.
But some people have feelings. Some people have more feelings than others, and some people are a lot stronger than others, and some people can take the truth, real honesty, which is what we were talking about yesterday as well.
Yeah.
And other people, a white lie doesn't hurt. So I kind of find that whole area quite grey, Graham.
Well, a white lie may not hurt, but it's when does a white lie turn into, I don't know, what's next from a white lie, a bigger lie.
Mm.
And, you know, again, it may not hurt you, but you don't know the consequences of that. Honesty is harder. Lying is more easier. Honesty is much harder.
If you try and go through a day without telling a single lie, it's one of the most difficult things you can do, apart from not swear as well. That's quite difficult.
Yeah,
unless your mum's in the room.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you have your automatic don't swear button, which you wish you could apply in other parts of your life. When was the last time you lied, Graham?
When was the last time I lied? It was probably on Monday.
And you're a minister?
I'm a Baptist minister, yeah.
So what did you lie about then?
Well, if I tell you that, my congregation might be listening.
Well, what did you lie about? Did you lie to protect someone or to protect yourself?
It was to protect someone.
That's all right. You're allowed to do that.
Well, thank you.
you have my forgiveness.
I will wrap the second coming and all that.
Okay, thanks for your help.
Thanks, Chris.
No problem. There's an idea for you here, Graham.
What's that?
There's a congregation, the church in Croydon, Surrey, has tripled since the vicar started dressing in a Darth Vader outfit to deliver sermons on the struggle against evil.
Well, I'll bear that in mind. Thanks for that.
It's 11 minutes to 9. It's Wednesday, November 10, 1999. The show's taking a turn today. A very interesting one from Martin Seymour. Dear Chris and the team, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. My experience 6 years ago, which happened following the untimely and bizarre death of my father, and my coming out of the closet mixed with a little recreational use of some substances led me to a complete meltdown. I'm not surprised. I really did hit my rock bottom, which nearly finished me. Luckily for me, I had great support from family and friends, and they helped me through it. I look back now and view trivial problems in my life as irrelevant, and I'm sometimes amazed at what brings others to their knees. One of my colleagues has an emotional breakdown every morning if she can't park a car. I do not know the extent of any of your issues, but whatever they are, take solace in the fact that it will pass. You'll learn from it, and it will make you stronger. You can believe in religion if you want to, but I prefer a belief in yourself, helped by your family and friends. I get totally racked off at times, but soon come round to see that I have got a fantastic loving partner called Martin, a great little flat, a salary I can live on, and two lovely little cats. I could always ask for more, but I can't see it making me any happier than I am now. Wow. From Chris. Top words. I could always ask for more, but I can't see it making me any happier. I like that a lot. He came up with that himself.
You've got an email from Christians in Contact.
Are they in contact with us again?
Oh, they're in contact. Dear Chris.
Yes.
We love you.
Thank you. Line 9, Michael in Belfast. Hello, Michael.
Good morning, Chris.
What have you got to say to us?
Chris, just to congratulate you for dealing with this subject this morning, because most programmes, I would say, run scared of it because of some sort of PC thing talking about religion. So just to say a couple of things, Chris, I've very much appreciated what folk have been saying and some excellent comments made. Just a question about how you prove whether something's true or not. Now, it seems to me I've worked in Africa and in Eastern Europe and here in Belfast, and I think there are three things strike me. The first is you can tell that something's true by observation, and I think you've only got to look around to see what the world's like, just here in Northern Ireland, if you see at the minute, man's inhumanity to man and so on, and women to women. The second thing that I've discovered is that all religions actually have a high God. This isn't something that people create. Even the African traditional religions have one big God figure behind it. And probably the most important on the observation thing is that it changes people's lives. Now, I've seen folk who are double murderers here whose lives have been changed, not by the peace process, but by actually a force outside themselves, which I would suggest as a Christian is God. Second thing just is the experience, Chris, and you've talked about that and I can't explain it any better. If you love somebody, you want other people to meet that person and you want them to share that experience. And finally, I think it's the issue of proof. Now, the bottom line was in 1969, when the first man landed on the moon, the Russians went up with a headline in a newspaper, "There is no God, we didn't see him." The New York Times responded by a fantastic headline saying that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Now that for me sums it up, because ultimately if you prove something, there's no need for faith. We have faith every day. You trust when you get on a bus, the guy's going to bring you to where he says he's going to. You trust your partner that when they say they love you, they do. You don't ask them to prove it. Once you do that, love's denied. So I'm simply saying, Chris, ultimately this is about faith and not about proof. And once you have that faith, the proof follows through experience.
Good words, sir.
All the best for the program.
Can I ask you one question?
Yes, of course, far away.
Why are men and women inhumane towards each other?
It's just unfortunately natural, and the problem is people won't face it. I had that when my 10-year-old was 4, he did something wrong, and I said, why did you do that? And he said, it wasn't me, Dad, it was the devil. Now, ultimately, as a Christian, I believe that that's true at the back of it all, but that doesn't deny human conscience. And unfortunately, Chris, left our own devices, we're selfish and arrogant. Me too.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot.
Not at all, Chris. All the best.
Cheers. That's Michael in Belfast. These people are such good speakers, aren't they?
Fantastic, aren't they?
I could listen to him all day.
Yeah, lovely.
Goodness me. Coming up between 9 and 9.30, we're giving away a trip to Sri Lanka with McDonald's, because that's what we do. Till it's over. We all know about that at some point in our lives. That's something old and something new. Two in a row on The Breakfast Show. As always at 9 o'clock. John?
What's that, big fella?
You look like you have something to say.
No, I was just reading this in the paper. It says, an attempted robbery at a Southampton store failed because a cashier couldn't read the writing on the demand note given to him. Now, has Jamie been in Southampton at all recently?
That's Jamie?
I have actually.
Jamie, the prayer has been so full of theological beings this morning, we've not had time to talk about your problem.
That's a shame, isn't it? And now it's just near the end.
Okay, well, Dan's got a problem, Holly's got a problem. We've all got problems, big or small. But are they surmountable? I think they probably are. Jamie, your problem is about your house.
I know.
That's what I was going to talk about.
Yeah.
But we'll talk about it tomorrow.
That. Okay.
It's very hard to deal with everybody's problems in one show.
Because could go down the pub.
Yeah, well, I don't think so. We don't deal with them there, we just put them off, I suppose.
Yeah.
Dan's got a problem. Dan doesn't even know what it is. Dan, do you know what your problem was that I was going to talk about? The fact that I think you're brilliant at what you do, right? I think you're a genius.
Thank you.
I think you're great to work with, and you're also a very good friend and a decent human being. But you are quite laid back.
Yeah.
And I think you're laid back because I know what you really want to do. You really want to be a musician.
Right.
That's what you really want to do. You prefer to do that than this. And what you do is you make out that it's your hobby, and it's not, it's your dream.
Yeah, you're right, yeah. I dabbled in a bit of production recently, and I must say, when I was in a recording studio doing that, I was in my element.
Because this is fun.
This is fantastic, though. This is.
But it's not as fulfilling as that would be for you.
I don't know.
Why don't you leave?
Are you trying to tell me something?
Why don't you just leave?
You want me to go?
I don't want you to go. But if you leave, that'll be okay.
Do you think that I don't like doing this? Then do you think?
Sorry.
I think you know I should be somewhere else doing something else.
No, but I think you know you're always welcome. Back.
But I don't want to go.
Okay, well, I'm just saying that you know where the door is. Hey, Chris, while I don't have an answer to your dilemma, what I can say is that you have a lot of people who don't even know you personally who are behind you and support you in what you do. That has to be good. Not everyone has that when you're feeling down. You and the team give many people, including myself, a lot of pleasure. And that's a good thing. Just give yourself some time and you'll be okay. From John Edwoski. Thank you, John.
Nice name.
Okay, we've done a lot today. We'll go to the ads and the travel, and we'll be back with some more music. We'll have a bit of R.E.M. for you when we come back. And as well as that, some Sammy Sonic. But we'll be back in just 2 minutes. That's the news jingle. I don't want to do the news now. Stop it.
No.
There you go. Stop the news. Oh, we haven't got time for the TV.
Don't worry.
Well, give the TV to Mark Forrest and he can read it out for you because he's up next. Yeah. Listen, have a great Wednesday and we'll see you Thursday. This has been the Virgin Radio Breakfast Show with John Revel, Holly Samos, Jamie Broadbent, Barry Ann Corrigor, John Webster, Joe Lisney and Dan McGrath. Cheers. That's the team and I love them. Ta-da.